I am going to tell you today about our research on ammonia-based energy storage, but perhaps more importantly, I'm going to talk to you about my vision. Perhaps it's a dream, and it's certainly a moonshot, about low carbon towards zero carbon renewable energy future. Now, the words renewable energy, two words, to me, they conjure up thoughts, images of wind turbines, of solar panels, of hydroelectric dams, and think about that for a moment, because these are different types of energy production. And the energy that is powered from the elements, from the global commons, from sun, wind, and water. And these elements are essentially ubiquitous. They're effectively cost-free. But we have a problem, of course, with this method of energy production, because we're also subject to the vagaries of the elements, because the wind doesn't always blow and the sun doesn't always shine. And this is an issue because our modern world, our way of life, survives and thrives on the fact that we can get energy when we want it, where we need it. And fossil fuels do that par excellence, all the way from power stations to petrol tanks. And so our challenge as we look to the future, if we're thinking about energy and wanting to decarbonize, is to get to a point where we can wean ourselves off fossil fuels and still have the energy that we want that we can store for a later time, or we can bottle it up and take it with us. So as well as renewables for producing energy, we need a properly renewable way of storing that energy. And what better place to look in the global commons if we just work with sun, wind, and water? How far can we go? And that's the story that I want to talk with you about today. Because if you think about our best known, in fact our biggest, most massive type of energy storage, it is renewable, it's hydroelectric storage. And what we do here, and this is, I'm a Scotsman, this is the Cruachan Reservoir up in the west of Scotland, and when we've got plenty of electricity, what we can do is that we can push the water uphill. And when we need the electricity again, we can drive the water down, and we get the electricity produced. And if you look at how much we get, it's about 0.1, or at least 1 kilowatt hour per tonne of water. That's what we get from pushing the water up and downhill. Now let's think of this, this is a global common, but what we have is we've energised the water. We've energised it using gravity. So what I want to do is I want to use a couple of the global commons, and I'm going to use sun, and I'm going to use water, and I'm going to use air, but I'm going to use the water and the air. So I'm going to take H2O, and I'm going to take nitrogen. And when I've got plenty of electricity, what I'm going to do, I'm going to create ammonia, and I'm going to push the energy uphill, but I'm going to do it chemically, not by gravity. And when I need that energy back, when there's a need for the energy, I'm going to combust the ammonia, or I'm going to move it in a fuel cell, and I get the energy back. So what I have is I have energized water effectively, but I've done it with a chemical reaction. And just look at the difference here. That's a kilowatt hour per ton that we're getting from doing it mechanically, pushing it uphill. And here we are, we're getting 6 kilowatt hours per kilogram. And quite importantly, that's basically half of what we get from petrol. And there's no carbon in here. And in fact, actually, when we combust ammonia, as you can see from the reaction here, what do we get? We get nitrogen. We get 78% of the air, no CO2 at all. And so I want to say, you know, this is water plus air, and I'm going to show that we can do it using sun and wind renewables. But Georgia talked about the history of ammonia. I'm not going to go way back to the Roman times, but I will go back 100 years. This is important for what I want to say at the end. Because in 1908, 1910, Fitzhaber and Carl Bosch managed to produce ammonia, and they used nitrogen from air, and they used hydrogen from water 100 years ago to do that. And nowadays we have 170 million tons of ammonia produced each year. And it's principally used for fertilizers. And the statistic is that about half of the world would go hungry if we didn't have ammonia, if we didn't have artificial fertilizers. And what's most pervasive of all about our lives, about your lives, about my lives, is that 40% of the nitrogen that sits in your bodies, that sits in my body, has actually made its way through the Haber-Bosch process. So it's a profound thing. But I want to talk about another history in a moment, and I'm going to give you a few statistics. Ammonia, it's a liquid at room temperature. If we can compress it in about 8 atmospheres of pressure, that's basically the same as butane and propane, liquid petroleum gas, LPG. It's also got a heat of combustion, as I said, that's about half of that of petrol. And you can see where I'm going to go, but I guess very few of you will know this next piece of history, because this is 1943, and this to me is an absolutely magnificent story. It's the middle of World War II. The Belgians have actually run out of diesel, it's been appropriated for war purposes, and their bus fleet grinds to a halt. This is in November 1942. In May 1943, the bus fleet was up and running with a mixture of ammonia and hydrogen, running the bus fleet tens of thousands of kilometers, accident-free, in the middle of World War II. I think it's an amazing piece of engineering. It's actually something that's rarely been done since. And I have an example here, in fact. This is Toyota last year, and they have a Toyota GT86 sports car that they've converted to ammonia and LPG. But the Belgians were right, and if you could read the small print here, they say that the best thing, if you want to make ammonia combust, it's a little bit difficult to do it, but if you've got, and it's best to use hydrogen, if you've got a small amount of hydrogen, it works very well. And that's the story that I'm going to tell you, because what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to produce an ammonia and hydrogen stream, and we want to be able to do that cheaply, and we want to be able to do that effectively. And that's where my colleagues and I this year have made, I think, a little bit of a breakthrough, because at the moment, if you want to split the ammonia, if you want to decompose it down to nitrogen and hydrogen, you're using expensive things like ruthenium catalysts. And what we've managed to do, and it's a different way of looking at the problem, but we've managed to take a combination of sodium and sodium amide, and that's actually basically cracking the ammonia, decomposing that ammonia, as well as the best ruthenium catalysts. And last month, actually, and this is not a pretty picture, but what we've managed to do with 0.3 of a gram of this catalyst of sodium amide, and that costs just pennies, in a reactor that's not much bigger than a AA battery, we've actually got 30 watts of power out. That's enough to power a television. And we want to upscale that, and if I take this upscaled here, so I take these 20 centimeter cubed reactors, put them side by side in something that's not much bigger than a biscuit tin, I can actually produce enough hydrogen to power that Toyota GT86, something that big. And we can do that with the amount of hydrogen that we can do at the moment. What we want to do, in terms of our developments, we have some funding to take this further. What we want to be able to do is to improve the reactor design. We want to be able to multiplex to make larger configurations of these reactors so that we can use them not just to power combustion engines, but to work with fuel cells as well. And on the fuel cell side of things, we want to work with a type of fuel cell that's not used very often these days, alkaline fuel cells, because they're very tolerant to ammonia. The traditional fuel cells, the ones that are used most often, are not. And alkaline fuel cells are, again, are a technology that were used that was used 50 years ago, and in fact, in a very appropriate and unusual environment, because it was the alkaline fuel cell that provided not just the electricity, but in fact the water for Neil Armstrong to go to the moon. So it was a proper moonshot. And this is the technology, in fact, that we want to develop again. And we have some clever ideas with anionic membranes that we want to be able to develop to be able to make these fuel cells work. So our ambition, one of the things we want to be able to do, is to take our reactor to crack the ammonia, to give us ammonia and hydrogen for the combustion engine, to give us lots of hydrogen for fuel cells. So that's one of the things we want to do. But we have a third project that's at an altogether bigger scale. And I spend half my time working at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, which is our biggest research lab in the UK. And we have funding to be able to work with our 40 kilowatt wind turbine. And what we're going to do is we're going to use that to electrolyze water to get the hydrogen. We're going to liquefy air to get the nitrogen. We're going to use the Haber-Bosch process, and we're going to make ammonia. And we're going to be doing that at the 40 kilowatt level. And so what we'll be able to do from an intermittent supply of energy is that we'll be able to get an on-demand production of electricity from combusting the ammonia. And within a decade, my ambition is to turn that into 100 megawatts. That will be perfect for the Rutherford site and for lots of academic reasons. But the biggest challenge that we got there, the biggest thing that I want to be able to show is that we can grid balance with this sort of technology that is zero carbon, completely using renewables, using the global commons, and that we can do that at a very large level. But I want to return to cars for a moment, because in fact there are already intermediate scale ammonia production plants that you can essentially buy off the shelf. So here is Oxford in the middle here, and I said earlier on in fact that ammonia has got the physical storage properties of LPG, liquid petroleum gas. So here we have, and this is from the LPG website in the UK, this is the infrastructure that's already in place. These are the LPG stations. Here's London here, Birmingham here, Wales here, Oxford in the middle. These are the LPG stations that we can already have, and in fact what we can do is we can take the LPG out of the tanks and put the ammonia straight in now. The infrastructure is in place, and that's very exciting. But here's this intermediate level ammonia production facility. It can be 1.5 megawatts of wind, it can be 1.5 megawatts of solar. And that comes in at about 2 million each of them a piece. And this produces 3 tons of ammonia a day. So what I want to do is I want to go through a little sum and ask, if we were to have this facility, and this is actually, you can bring this in on 5 container lorries, if we had this on every forecourt in the UK, how much of the UK car fleet could we run? So the Department of Transport has a very precise measurement of the number of miles that we do each year, 303.7 billion miles in 2013. Now, I said already that ammonia has half the combustion, the heat of combustion of petrol. So I'm going to say that we can get 20 miles per gallon from an ammonia car. That would be 40 equivalent for petrol, and we'll only do better with that. Now we've got 3 tons a day, and so that's 7 miles per kilogram equivalent, and that's 21,000 miles per day. That's what this particular station would do, and that looks like a number that's much, much smaller than the 303.7 billion. But I got, let's say, 330 days in the year. And I've got 9,000 petrol stations in the UK. So let's do that number, and we can see we've got quite a few zeros here, and I'm not going to ask you to do that, I'm going to give you the answer. That's 62.4 billion miles, that's 20% of what we have of the cars in the UK already, and we could do that now. So what we need to be able to do is to put these stations in place, and we need to be able to develop the technologies that I was talking about earlier. And so this takes me to the end, because what I'm saying is that at the beginning I talked about renewable energy, and that's all about energy production. It's using the global commons, it's using solar, it's using wind, it's using water. And I'm saying when it comes to energy storage, we should be using sun and wind and air and water as well. And that's what ammonia does. That's what it gives us. When we combust the ammonia, there's no CO2. It's just nitrogen, which we returned to the atmosphere. And so the energy production and the energy storage that's totally renewable actually gives us not just attending to the energy trilemma of affordability, reliability, and sustainability, but it solves it, it resolves it. But I want to say that there's actually, in fact, a bigger level, a bigger moonshot that we can aim at, because ammonia already provides food for half the planet. When you combust ammonia, when you use ammonia in a fuel cell, what comes out at the end is water. So we got food, we got water, I've talked about energy, and in fact, what ammonia can do is it can contribute to a bigger issue, a bigger dream of contributing to the food, water, energy nexus. And I think that's a dream. I think it's a moonshot. Thank you. Yeah.